just some really quick context setting. So this is data from BP's Statistical Review, and this is the history of energy in the world. So there's total energy there, going up, and you've heard from me and Andy Jarvis especially about how that's exponential. It's been 2.4% since year dot. There it is, going on its way, and that's what the fossil fuel has been doing. That's the fossil fuel component of it. And we all know that that's got to stop happening. I won't go on about that. And just to break down the fossil fuel, there's the coal there in blue and the oil there in green and the gas there in red, all still rising. And then down here you've got the hydro in bright blue, nothing spectacular but slowly climbing. And then you've got the, in purple here, you've got nuclear. And then there's two here right along the bottom, the wind and the solar, just crawling along the bottom. And that's the history of energy. And just to have a look at what BP outlook is. So this is what they're saying is going to happen up to 2050. And so energy's going to do that, and they're saying, well, fossil fuel energy will stop growing quite so quickly. It's still going up in 2050. As the coal and the gas, there's a bit of a story about gas becoming more prominent and coal beginning to tail off and stuff. And then you can just about, you know, some growth here in bits and pieces, you can just about see solar coming off the ground and so on. So if that scenario happens, then all the climate change stuff is going to be total, complete disaster. That's as clear as daylight. So that's where BP are coming from as of when I took that data off their statistical review just a few months ago. So against that context, Chris Goodall is about to tell us that the energy problem is solved. So even if he's only a quarter right, it's a really very good news story. So this is Chris Goodall. So he's the author of a few great books: How to Live a Low Carbon Life, Green Business Guide, 10 Technologies to Fix Energy and Climate. He also does a fantastic blog, which is usually the first thing I read on a Monday morning, perhaps sometimes before I get out of bed even, his Carbon Commentary, which is full of kind of all kinds of latest news on what's going on in the energy and carbon world. And most recently, this book, The Switch, which is all about what's going on in solar power and the possibility of a switch to solar power. So, it's great to have him come up from Oxford here to talk to us. Chris Goodall, give it to you.
Thank you.
No, always the difficult one. No, sorry, yeah. Another one. Sorry. As Mike said, it would be better, I think, if we could make this session as interactive as possible. So if you want to say something, throw some brickbats, please put your hand up and we'll have a discussion. There's a lot of statistical material in here, but there's nothing that's very technical. Some of it is highly contentious, and I think it needs to be challenged, so please don't hesitate to do that. I want to stress right throughout this talk that although I entitled it The Energy Problem is Solved, that doesn't mean to say that we're going to get out of jail without any cost whatsoever. Clearly, as well as the technical solutions, which I believe are now firmly there, we need political will, we need community will to make the transition to a low carbon future happen. Now, if you go across the Western world, there is broad support, strong support, for the use of renewables, even in countries like this one, where you'd get the impression, if the Daily Mail was any guide, that any wind turbine is a complete disaster from an ecological point of view. So we have the basis of a political decision to make the transition to renewables. And in some ways, we have political commitment as well. At least those signatures in Paris 16 months ago suggested something. What my talk about is essentially about the role of solar power in giving enough energy to everybody in the world for everybody to have a reasonable standard of living. There is nothing now which is going to affect standard of living to those, if you've got enough food, than enough energy. And what I'm trying to suggest in this presentation is that we're now in a position where solar photovoltaics can provide that energy to all 7 or 10 billion, eventually, people in the world, at a cost which is now already, in most parts, in many parts of the world, lower than fossil. You could say that the solar power era started in 1958, almost 60 years ago. That is one of the first, that's the third American satellite, one of the first things to be put into orbit around the planet. The Soviet leader at the time, Nikita Khrushchev, called that a grapefruit and regarded it not as a proper satellite, but that is something that is still visible in the night sky. It stopped working, it stopped sending signals back 6 years after it was put into orbit, but it's going to be there for 300 or 400 years, and you can still see it if you've got a passive telescope. Those there are solar panels, and that's the first, I think, as far as I could find from my book, the first clear, beneficial, commercial use of solar panels. It's about, in total across that satellite, about a quarter of a watt, as far as I could tell, although the data's very sketchy. The bloke holding it there is Roger Easton, whose other main claim to fame, other than developing some of the electronics for this satellite, is the invention of the global positioning satellite, GPS system, without which, of course, now we would be lost all the time. But that was a real satellite, and when I give this talk, sometimes people don't believe that that was actually put into orbit on a rocket. But that is that satellite being, this is just anecdotal stuff, forgive me, this is away from the core themes of the talk, but I thought it'd be interesting to see that it took that much to put that satellite into orbit, geostationary orbit. Now, 3 years later, we come to develop a little bit more of solar photovoltaics. You can see this is the fifth American satellite that went up. And by now, it's got really quite large areas of solar photovoltaics over it. And it, that satellite continued to work for a considerably longer length of time. So, even in that 3 years, enormous progress. From tiny little things right up to things which look more like the conventional solar panels of today. Still enormously costly, as you can imagine. These were thousands and thousands of dollars to develop. And we had made relatively slow progress. The photovoltaic effect was understood well over 100 years before that, and Einstein's Nobel Prize was not for the theories of relativity, but in fact for a better understanding of the photovoltaic effect. That is the process by which a photon of light landing on a semiconductor pushes an electron and makes it possible an electric current. We've seen enormous progress since the 55 years since that second satellite. And we now have, across the world, something of the order of 310 gigawatts of photovoltaics sitting there on... No, please, I mean, you can't do that.
My son, sorry.
It's always nice to have a proper age range in the audience. And in the last year, 2016, we installed worldwide more solar photovoltaics on the ground and on roofs of houses than were actually in existence 5 years ago. So progress is rapid, it's been pretty consistent at around 40% a year growth every year since that second satellite in 1961. And there's no reason to believe that this will stop. But what's happening is that we're moving away from installing solar photovoltaics, solar panels, in Europe and in America, to where they're principally now being installed in China and the rest of Asia. So that's the green one is the conventional world, Europe. Then you've got America. But above that, you can see that China, India, other places in Asia are becoming far more important as the places where this solar is being installed on the ground. So, the reason for mentioning this is we may well have an impression in this country as a result of government policy changes over the last couple of years that solar is pretty much dead. It is not. It is growing faster than ever before, in terms of absolute volume, faster than ever before. And last year saw a 33% increase in total installed capacity. The growth continues. Not as fast as the 40% of the 1980s, but still at a rate which is very rapid indeed. One of the striking things when I was doing the research for this book was that how I went back into the past and I looked at what people said would happen to the installed capacity of solar photovoltaics. That every single international and national institution consistently, year after year, time after time, underestimated the extent, the speed of growth of PV around the world. And the learning effect inside these organizations is almost non-existent. So I'll go to that point now about that Mike raised right at the beginning. Well, if BP is saying that solar is only going to be an insignificant portion of world energy supply, why are they wrong? Well, I believe they are probably wrong, and probably very wrong by an order of magnitude. But the reason is that humankind finds it very, very difficult to adjust to rapid changes. We're all essentially incapable of understanding the power of compound growth. That's a big flaw of the way the humankind thinks. But organizations particularly get tied to particular views of the world, and it's very difficult for them to adjust to changing reality. International Energy Agency, the Paris-based club for the rich world, the OECD world, essentially gets this wrong every single year. So you've got the 2012 report on the prospects for renewable energy, 2013, 2014. And every year, yes, they upped the forecast slightly, but more and more they fall behind what actually happened. So in the 2012 report, that's only 3 years before 2016, because it's produced the following year, they got the installation wrong, and they never got quite anywhere near up to the extent of understanding the rate of change in the rest of the world. And that's a problem wherever you look at it. We find, if you look at those numbers in a slightly different way, that they make small adjustments each year to their expectations of future growth. They don't ever say, crikey, we got this wrong. Actually, solar power is growing far faster than anybody expected, and it's going to be embarrassing, but we ought to admit it. So even the last 2014 report estimated that solar installations in 2016 would be less than half what was actually installed. And if I may say, that is absolutely consistent across all forecasts I've ever seen, with one exception, the great solar entrepreneur Jeremy Leggett, who would be a very good person to have to come and talk here, said some time ago that solar would be the dominant source of energy, but he's pretty much the only person who ever said that until the last few years. Indeed, in the case of the government department now in charge of energy in the United Kingdom, they are making forecasts for the projection of future costs, which are still declining a tiny amount each year. But the reality is that across the world, solar costs have been falling at between 10 and 20%. The cost of actually getting electricity from solar photovoltaics has been falling at 10 to 20% a year, pretty much over that last 60 years since the first satellites in space. So we're unable as a race, as a society, to keep up with the fact that PV is an astonishingly important and rapidly changing source of energy. It is, however, still only 2%, roughly, of total world electricity supply. And electricity is a small fraction of the total energy needs of the world. So, it's very tempting to say, this is so insignificant, it's never going to make a real difference. But, if we continue to grow at roughly the 33% that solar PV grew last year, and solar PV is also becoming more efficient, that's just the amount of gigawattage on the ground, then it implies a doubling of that capacity from today's figures, in the case of 33% growth, every 2.5 years. So in 2.5 years' time, we'll have twice as much capacity to generate electricity as we did today, if we continue to grow at 33%. And there's every reason to believe that the rate of growth will continue, not least because China and India have both independently committed in the last 2 weeks to install enough solar in their economies between now and 2021 to keep that growth rate going. Not, doesn't get into the British press, that's what you have to read the Sunday evening newsletter to hear about, but really the fact is that Asia has taken over the mantle of growth on energy, of development on energy, from the West and in particular from the United States. Now, if we have that compound interest effect continuing into the future, this is how long it's going to roughly to take for solar energy and anything that's associated with it, complementing it, to get to the point where it is 100% of world energy supply. That green dotted line here, I'm sorry, it's a very messy graph. It may not be possible to see it very clearly. But what this says is, if we continue to grow on this red curve, which is the 33% growth rate a year, if we continue to do that, by 2030-2031, we have generated enough, we will have enough solar photovoltaics on the ground to provide for the entire electricity need of the world. If it grows faster than that, if it grows at 40% historic average, then by that stage we'll have three or four times as much energy as the world, electricity as the world needs, which is roughly what we need to give everybody in the world a comfortable amount of energy all the time, which I put in my book, I think is roughly 3 kilowatts is what we need. That doesn't mean very much, that's the equivalent of a kettle and a half boiling. If you live in the UK, you're consuming roughly 4 kilowatts constantly. Difficult to imagine, isn't it? But that's roughly what we need, down from 5 kilowatts 15 years ago. So we're making progress. The OECD as a whole is consuming less energy, but of course we need to give energy both to people who have got some energy but very unreliable electricity, and to the 1.3 billion who don't have any electricity at all. So at 33% growth rates, it takes until 2029 to provide for all the electricity in the world from solar PV. In other words, only 12 or 13 years away. And that's the future which is attainable for us, but we will only get there if we decide to keep it moving. And the reason why it's important to keep it moving is what, on this chart, is called Swanson's curve. Other people call learning curve, and experience curve, declining cost curve. What the world has found fairly consistently and reliably since those first satellites in 1960 or so, is that for every doubling of accumulated production of solar photovoltaic equipment, the panels, the wiring, the inverters that you need to turn the DC into AC, every time you've doubled the accumulated capacity, the cost of running a solar photovoltaic system has fallen by 20%. So, as you can tell, therefore, just very roughly, if we're growing at 33% and it takes 2.5 years to double, then every 2.5 years we'll actually reduce the cost of electricity from solar by 20% if these trends continue. And I see no reason why we shouldn't.
Chris, yeah. Last question about that. You mean the marginal, the latest marginal cost?
Yes.
Or the average cost across the whole
thing? I'm sorry, that is indeed. So what I'm talking about is the cost of putting some new equipment out in the field and using it to generate electricity. So marginal, the increment.
Quick question about the last point you made about the on average we use 4 or 4.5 kilowatts
hour
requirement, and that has reduced.
About four.
So does that include, is that just domestic use or does it include industrial
The whole economy.
Okay.
So there are whatever it is, 66 million people in the UK. And we use electricity, we use other fuels for various things. But if you divide the total amount of energy we use on a running basis with the number of people, you get to about 4 kilowatts, down from about 5 kilowatts. So we need, I'm sorry, this is a little bit technical, but that means we need roughly 100 kilowatt hours of energy a year. And when David Mackay, just as a matter of interest, when the great David Mackay wrote his book, Sustainable Energy Without Hot Air, 10 years ago, it was 125 kilowatt hours. So the reason for mentioning this is any view that the world needs more and more and more energy per person isn't true. And I have had long and vigorous debates with Mike about this. I see clear signs of stabilization and fall. Once you're in a mature economy, you actually need less energy. And Mike will intervene to tell me how long I am.
Can I just ask about your the costings of the energy, if the costs are going to go down and down, that implies there's an endless supply of raw materials to produce these panels. And presumably, if there isn't, the cost of the raw materials will increase and then you start to offset.
The key raw material currently in in solar photovoltaics is grains of sand. And I would put it to you that, as far as we're concerned, there are enough grains of sand to meet all human need a million times over. But later in the presentation, I'll say, actually, the future probably will not even be grains of sand. It will be simpler molecules which are available in vast quantities at very low prices. So I don't think in the case of the conversion of light into electricity, we will see any resource shortages. and I'm waiting to be challenged on that.
Would you like to reduce the electricity need, the air
yeah.
in the future, to stabilise?
Yeah.
Presumably, though, you are expecting there to be a dramatic switch from other fuels to electricity. Electric cars, the obvious
thing. Right. Indeed, yes. So if I said electricity, I meant energy. I apologise. So what I mean is the total amount of energy you need. So, for example, when you switch from your internal combustion engine...
So you're taking all energy?
I'm taking everything. Yes. I'm taking electricity and transport fuels and wood for heating or whatever across the globe. Just to make that, just go on about that point. So if you've got an internal combustion engine car, that uses roughly four times as much energy to move as an electric car. That doesn't mean to say it has four times as low greenhouse gas connotations. But we are getting more efficient, and electric cars are going to be an important element of pushing the average global need for energy down to a low level in the future.
In addition to thinking about the cost of producing solar energy, don't you also have to think about the cost of consuming it in terms of the cost of buying all of the appliances and how expensive they can be compared to conventional appliances?
What electric appliances?
Yeah, I have friends who are building a house on top of a mountain in Maine, and they decided not to build it off the grid because they realized that the expense of getting the dishwasher and the, I don't know, whatever all the things they're going to have to buy to run their household, the outlay for buying the things they would need to consume the solar energy was prohibitive.
Right, so I think we're talking about here the transition to from an AC system, i.e. a national grid type system, to a direct current type system off-grid. And it is indeed true that if you want to buy a DC refrigerator, it's going to cost you more per unit of cooling capacity today than AC. But that may not persist. And perhaps we can talk about this when we get on to the question of how we get energy into the 1.3 million people who don't have any electricity at all. Because that's going to be the thing which pushes DC appliances down to being lower cost than AC. There's no reason why AC appliances should be cheaper, because actually it's easier to run almost every single domestic appliance on DC than AC. It's just we've not manufactured many of them.
Is this largely based on rooftop solar, or is it also utility?
No, this is principally utility.
And if so, how much land is being acquired?
Yeah. There's a very tedious section in my book about this. worldwide, somewhere between 3/4 and 1% of all the worldwide land area, in order to provide enough energy for everybody in the world. It's when you get to the UK, there are two big problems, Bangladesh and the UK. Bangladesh, highly dense population, there, you might need 15% of Bangladesh. So that's not going to happen. Sorry, I may have misremembered the number there. But it's roughly similar to that in the UK. So if we want to get all our energy from photovoltaics in the UK, we would use a lot of land. But we are lucky. We are the best endowed source of renewable energy in the world. And it's time people kept on saying that, because we have the opportunity to develop technologies which are going to be useful elsewhere in the world, but they'll work here first. Tidal lagoons being a perfect example of that. But the fact is that for the UK, if we wanted to power ourselves across the year with photovoltaics sitting in fields, we would use a lot of land area. But I make the point, and George Monbiot has been talking about this a lot over the last 2 or 3 weeks, that about 20% of the UK's land cover is given over to the extraordinarily unproductive cultivation of sheep. And if instead on those lands we put solar photovoltaic panels, we would get a lot more energy than the food energy we would ever get from that. And I suggest that might be a way to So I'm sorry this is a little technical, but what I'm trying to say is, sorry.
I won't challenge you on whether you should put photovoltaics all over the Lake District, but I will challenge you on your forecasting. So you've told us how bad we are at forecasting and applied that to solar. how have you factored in your forecasting for energy usage? If we're so bad at forecasting, have you factored that badness of forecasting into your energy usage?
Well, we've got a lot of history now. Energy use, total energy use has been going down in the UK per person for about 15 years now, edging down between 1 and 1.5% a year. Now, it varies partly according to whether it's cold or warm during the winter, which is a big determinant in the UK. But there's a real consistent pattern, both here and in, with the exception of Australia, every country in the developed world. We are not using any more. We seem to have got enough energy to do what we want. And as time goes on, energy efficiency erodes the energy we actually use. I mentioned electric cars. I mean, transport fuel is roughly 25% of our national energy footprint. If we switched car transport to electric vehicles, that would go down to something of the order of 12%. So there'd be a net reduction. So I don't think I'm being too cavalier about how much energy we're going to need in the future. I can't see any reason why the current trends are changing, just as I can't really see any reason why, looking at the technology, why photovoltaics won't continue to get more efficient. But that is the highly contentious statement.
On the sheep issue, very highly contentious. I think the issue is that land which is only suitable for sheep isn't going to be suitable for solar photovoltaics because of the terrain or the landscape value or all these other reasons. I thought the issue about that if you do put solar on farmland in fields, you can graze sheep on it.
Yes.
So it's compatible with sheep, rather than a substitute for sheep.
No. I spent part of my time, in case that does seem incredibly insensitive to your permission in this beautiful area of the world, I spend part of my time in Snowdonia with my wife, where we sit in fields with sheep around. I went to see a very, very large solar farm in Leicestershire, about 2 years ago, and I met the shepherd who was in charge of keeping the sheep in this 20 hectare solar farm. And he said to me that the growth rate of the sheep was better and the disease, they were more free from disease than before the solar was installed. There was more sheep growing capacity, if you regard that as a good thing, in those fields now than there was before the photovoltaics. Because the dear little things are sheltered from the wind. The grass still grows underneath most of the solar panel if it's properly far off the ground, and they can shelter from rain and from the sun. So both disease and productivity were improved. That's anecdotal. I've heard it from one other farmer as well, but he was probably not many of them around here, but the kind of farmer who only farms because he's wealthy enough to do so. But he made the same contention. So this is the critical number, and I apologise it's taken so long to get here. If we continue to grow the world photovoltaic capacity, those big utilities farms sitting on the ground in China and India at 33% a year, and that cost curve, that Swanson curve, continues to operate, then at 33% growth, we have enough to supply all the electricity needs of the world by 2029. And the cost per unit of electricity generated will have fallen to about 30% of today's levels. So I'm an economist, so I believe in economic models, so I'm going to state that that's my central thesis, and you can say how unreasonable it is.
So before you move on, I'll ask another question about that. So in the graph that you showed, with the three lines intersecting, you showed current electricity use.
Yeah.
Not projected future energy use.
Yeah.
Electricity use, but current
Energy use. Electricity. Yeah. Sorry.
But you've already said that 1.3 billion people in the world don't have access to electricity. So to compare the projected growth in PV with the current use of electricity is not a value comparison.
Okay. So if my statistics are right, and it's a good point, I'm wrong by 2 years, just over 2 years. Now, I'm not, you know, growth curves, people say, oh, but growth curves don't ever go like that. You look over a lot of things like transistors and other semiconductor-based things like photovoltaics, actually they do. There will be more semiconductors made in the world this year than were made in the entire history of humankind up till the end of 2014. There are instances of truly remarkable progress and reliable progress, and I think this is one of them.
Right. So isn't the difference between growth in transistors and growth in solar panels,
yeah,
one key difference, that when transistors started out they were the size of a baked bean tin and now you can hardly see them with a microscope, yeah, whereas a solar panel capable of capturing a meter square of sunlight will always be there?
Yeah. Right, so these people are trying to do something about that. Okay. Two of the most interesting companies in the world, Dresden-based Heliotech, which makes a solar film which is printed on essentially a printing machine, a roll-to-roll printing machine, onto a substrate of a thin plastic. This is that solar photovoltaic is 5 microns thick, compared to approximately 200 microns for today's silicon. So I would contend that is, at least in potential, going to give us the kind of scope for cost reduction that Mike said that we saw in transistors. And there, here is Oxford's most glamorous scientist, Henry Snaith, who set up a business called Oxford PV, using a completely different class of material. These are called organic photovoltaics, with carbon-based molecules. These use perovskites, which is a structure of material, not of a particular material itself, but once again has strong photovoltaic capacity. The photon hits the molecule and an electron is dislodged. And that also can improve the productivity of a solar panel twofold. Those two companies have made faster advances in electrical efficiency of photovoltaics than has ever occurred in silicon. Now, they may not end up being cost competitive, but they've just, both of them, raised significantly new rounds of cash from commercial sources of venture capital. My bet is that one of these two is going to provide us with the dominant silicon replacement technology for PV within 15 years. So somebody had a question, sorry.
I did, and it's really not a question. It linked to what we were talking about before, what the lady over there said about her friends who are building a house on a mountain in Maine, is that right? And about the fact that the cost of all of those, the extra stuff they have to buy.
Different stuff.
Yeah, and it was linked, I think, to the point you were making as well about the fact that it's not a challenge and I don't think I need a response, it's just I wanted to say it before I've got it. This may be able to revolutionise and meet demands and be cheaper than and blah blah blah, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's a model for sustainability if 1.3 billion people then buy loads of stuff. Dishwashers and detergents as only being a tiny, tiny illustration of that.
Can you repeat the question?
The lady was saying that if we give everybody a lot of energy, we also are giving them a lot of capacity to buy things which use that energy, and this is not a model for sustainability. Is that a fair summary? Because in the end, the sustainability of the world depends upon living within a limited resource. Now, okay, we could talk for hours about this. My contention is that you can give people energy in ways that are completely life-changing, but which don't require the consumption of lots of new things. But here's the counterexample. This is the way the world's moving, in my opinion. Instead of building out national electricity grids in India, Kenya, Nigeria, places where there are tens, hundreds of millions of people without electricity, we give them the capacity to make their own electricity through solar panels. This is a London-based company called Beebox, installing at rapidly enhancing rate. And what they do is they put solar panels on roofs on a pay-as-you-go basis, like mobile phones. So if you don't pay, you don't get any electricity. And what they give people now is light phone charging and a TV. And that's what people, you know, that's what they found, according to the founder who spoke, I listened to him speaking a couple of months ago, that this makes, this is life-changing for people who don't have any access. But it does mean that the world then has to consume a lot more TVs. Well, you know, we get the same. It's going to be very, very difficult to keep the world together if the UK, with its 2.3 TVs per household, says to people in the less developed parts of the world, no, you can't have one. Now, so we have to find ways. My response, really, to the lady's point is, we have to find ways of making that with renewable energy and with as minimal resources as possible. That, by the way, this TV uses 7 watts. What uses 7 watts? Well, that's the standby of a TV in the UK 10 years ago. So we're making huge progress on energy efficiency, and it means that that panel there can give a household 3 or 4 hours of TV a night if it wants it.
Do they get a battery from that?
There's a battery, sorry, it's one. There's a storage system as well. And it's linked into the mobile phone network, so that if you run out of money, you have to phone in and add some credit on your mobile phone. So when I was writing this book, when I was doing the research for this, I went to as many English language newspapers in the developed world as I could find. And every single conversation in those papers, comments below the line, things like that, journalists working, said consistently, well, okay, we have learned that we can build out mobile phone networks within the space of 10 years. Look, 15 years ago, you know, 1% of Nigerians had a mobile phone. Today there are more mobile phones in Nigeria than the adult population. You know, that's the model which they see, and that's entirely dependent upon taking companies like Beebox, and there are 15 companies like this around the world, most of them German, as it turns out, but just happened to hear this book talking. And that is the way in which we're going to get electricity into the places which don't have any chance of getting electricity. So the model will change. And that's the thing. The next thing people will want, I suspect, is a refrigerator. And there that lady was talking about the cost of DC refrigerators. There's no reason why this wouldn't be a DC refrigerator as well.
But the model which drives capitalism is obsolescence and continual replacement. So the companies who sell this have got no interest in making these stable technologies and low cost in terms of energy use.
I would be more optimistic about capitalism than that. We're going to get into some very deep water. But this thing here, 20 years ago, would have lasted, 10 years ago would have lasted at most 20 years. It now probably, unless it's hit by extremely heavy hail, will last for 35
years. Yes,
it will
last for 35 years, but you'll be getting average and your phone coming in, you need to replace it next year because there's a better model.
But one brief comment on that. This is true for our consumer devices because we are saturated and they have to build in new features, more flat, less explosive or whatever, so that we buy the next generation. Here they have a blue ocean of market.
Yes.
So there's no need to artificially reduce the lifetime or create a demand because there's, for a while, a growing pool of users.
So I'll put a highly contentious assertion out and then we can debate it. Is that unless the world finds a way of giving roughly 3 kilowatts to the people, everybody in the world, we have zero chance of solving the climate change problem because it would just be seen as a way of which we're closing down on the developing world. Now, let's hope, what we're seeing, and what tomorrow's inauguration represents the handing of the baton of world leadership from the United States to China. And I suspect, you know, we will be, you know, our gates will move more east, towards the east, because that's where all these changes have been driven from. Now, it may be that China does what it's doing today, partly because it's good for Chinese exports. These are all made in China, pretty much now, except for the very efficient ones, which are made in Germany and in the United States. So China sees this capitalist opportunity in spades.
Yeah, so far you seem to be talking about flat panel technologies. Can you comment on concentrated technologies?
Right. So I've said look, here's my contention. I mustn't take too much time, but my contention is that PV is going to be the dominant part of the world energy system in 20 years. Solar power with devices like that are going to be the way in which the majority of electricity and energy in the whole are going to be created. And we're going to use electricity for cars, we're going to use electricity for heat, and so on and so forth. So there will be much more use of electricity in the global energy system. But in many places, that's not going to do what we need. And I'm going to answer the question. But here's another technology which has undergone the most extraordinary changes in the last 5 years. If you had said 5 years ago that offshore wind would be competitive in the North Sea with conventional wind with other sources of electricity generation, you would have been laughed out of this room. But what we see last week was that, and this is out of date, because when I did this chart, the latest results haven't come in. So a group led by Shell said that it would put offshore wind into a shallow part of the Dutch North Sea, a shallow part, so not the most difficult part, a shallow part of the Dutch North Sea, for an electricity cost of €54 per megawatt hour. Now, don't worry about the number. That is roughly what it would take to put a new gas-fired power station on the ground in the Netherlands or the United Kingdom. Now, we're not completely there yet, because that excluded some costs, the transmission costs, for example. But we've seen systematic, sustained, reliable decreases in the cost of solar photovoltaics. We've seen it also in the case of offshore wind, in a way that absolutely no one predicted. And it's going to be possible for the UK to put a large part of its electricity generating capacity out into the North Sea. Just another point about our failure to keep up with these things. Those Dutch North Sea offshore wind farms are now coming in auctions at roughly half the price that the British government says currently is the cost, underlying cost of offshore. That's a forecast produced in October and November of last year. But that's not just big technology. So I should say I have a very small stake in this company, but this, I should also say that every single small wind turbine company in the world has gone bankrupt at one stage or another. This is my latest fleet. This time it's different. incredibly cheap. I invested in this company because I met the entrepreneurs, and they all came out of automotive component engineering. So they'd grown up, they were in their late 40s, early 50s, and they'd spent their entire working lives petrified that something would go wrong, which means that Toyota had to recall 2 million cars or something. So these are people unbelievably sensitive both to cost and to reliability. And I thought this was a gamble worth making. And this is the latest iteration of it. It's a vertical wind turbine going like that. Those costs around $200 a piece to make. And that is going to be a technology which it ought to be possible to use to complement PV supply in the rest of the world, and particularly in the UK, where they've got a lot of very good windy areas where this will work. But the gentleman was talking about concentrating solar power. Sorry, I can't remember what it was.
Yeah.
And this is the most interesting recent illustration of this. These are thousands and thousands of heliostats, mirrors which reflect the sun onto the top of that tower there and generate enormous heat when it's done. In there is a salt which melts when the heat gets to 200 or 300 degrees, I can't remember. And then that heat is retained and is used when the electricity is needed to generate electricity. This is the Crescent Dunes plant in Nevada, and this company here, Solar Reserve, is trying to exploit that around the world. Now, the problem for them at the moment is, yes, that can give you at least 8 hours storage, and you can run this so that it only generates electricity when solar photovoltaics aren't generating, but it's about 3 times the price of photovoltaics. So 10 years ago, this was going to be a technology which was cost competitive with photovoltaics, but it's simply not come down at the same rate in cost as PV. But nevertheless, in places with very peaky demand, such as South Africa, this is being used as a technology to allow the provision of electricity, usually at the end of the afternoon, when PV would be falling away. So it's a way of storing electricity as well as generating it at the same time. And this is another way of doing it. This is developed by some friends of mine actually in Oxford. This is The first, this here, is the first anaerobic digestion plant ever built in Africa. Possibly Africa south of the Sahara, but that's their boast, they're saying in Africa. What anaerobic digestion does, it takes rotting organic matter, it seals it from air. When it rots, therefore, the organic matter produces methane, the main constituent of natural gas. And that can be burnt in a gas turbine at the time you want to generate electricity. And the great thing about this technology, according to its founder, and he's the greatest salesman I've ever met in my life, is that you can use plants which have no food value and do not replace food value plants, because they can be grown on land which is far too dry to grow conventional foods. And that's prickly pear, and he's using that as the main foodstuff that goes into that anaerobic digestion plant. I'm talking here about complements to solar photovoltaics. One of the most interesting ones for the UK is the Tidal Lagoon, which was sort of given a formal seal of approval without any commitment to money a couple of weeks ago. This is Swansea Bay. This is the 6-kilometer wall around Swansea Bay. These are the turbines. They catch energy going in and out. The tidal range in the Severn is pretty much the largest of the world, with an exception of a place in Canada. So you can get a very large amount of energy from that swishing of the Severn back and forward twice a day. But the idea is to put these in many places around the UK, because tidal times vary approximately 6 hours over the course that goes from north of the UK to the south of the UK. So you can get pretty reliable electricity all the way. Whether that ends up by being cost competitive, I don't know. But in my view, and this is a statement from the company itself, and I thoroughly agree with it, it's the project the Victorians would have done rather than nuclear power. Not against nuclear power for environmental reasons, I just think the costs look astonishingly high, and it's proving very difficult to complete the panels. Now, Mike, how long can I go on from without breaching all the rules?
I think normally.
Is that right?
If you know, yeah.
Okay, so those technologies, so we talked about PV and how it's going to go down in price, and how my contention that it will become the dominant source of electricity in the world. And by the way, the CEO of Shell in September 2015 said the same thing. So it's not just nutcases like me who are saying this. There is an understanding that at some point in the future, solar photovoltaics probably will be the dominant electricity source. So we've got some complements to it as well, because you know there's not much sun in the winter in the UK, but we have offshore wind, we might have tidal lagoons and so on and so forth. We might have other things like geothermal technology, which we can use to build our reliability based upon solar photovoltaics as the dominant source. Now, what we're finding increasingly as well in the UK and elsewhere is that we can adjust our pattern of electricity demand. So people of my age grew up with the sense that electricity was there to follow, the amount of electricity we produced would simply follow the amount of electricity that was needed at any one point in time. So it's an entirely passive system, it just produced enough electricity to meet needs. What we're finding as digital technologies grow more and more powerful is that we can adjust short-term electricity demand to a really rather substantial extent to match the availability of supply. So it's not demand determining supply, it's now supply partly determining demand. National Grid in the UK and lots of other grids around the world are beginning to use this as a way of making sure we don't run out of electricity. So even though our plant margins in the UK, the amount of generating capacity we have, is low by historic standards, we have come nowhere near during the course of this winter to running out of electricity, partly because we're getting better and better and better at this. Adjusting demand to meet supply, so-called automated demand response. There's not a single appliance in the world where you cannot adjust the amount of electricity you use in response to short-term variations in supply. Let's go through that. That was mainly about, you can do the same, to a surprising extent, you can cut domestic electricity demand in the same way. By, for example, turning off your refrigerator for 3 hours. You won't even notice the difference, but that will be done at a time when electricity is possibly five times as expensive in the wholesale markets as it was. Now, so another big change. So I said, look, offshore wind, onshore wind to some extent, PV, falling in cost dramatically rapidly, according to some reliable metrics. The same thing appears to be happening with the batteries, and particularly the kind of batteries that go into cars, the lithium-ion batteries. Which Tesla has pushed. This is a piece of academic research here. from the data from 2014, when a Swedish group looked at projections for the cost of batteries over the course of time. Now, what they showed was this sharp curve. It's at least as sharp a curve as that cost curve for PV that we saw earlier. That was about 20% for every doubling. This might be 22% for every doubling, and that means in compound terms, that's quite a lot. And what they said was, they asked people, experts in the industry, to project the cost going out to 2030. And as with solar photovoltaics, to a quite remarkable extent, everybody was too conservative. So I got some data. So that's published, that figure there. That's the cost to make batteries for the new GM electric car, the GM Bolt or the Volt, whatever it's called. It's just gone on sale in California. And that's a figure I got from someone who runs a electric motor racing company, Tesla, told them. Was now their cost of electric batteries for cars. So I suggest those, the actual cost curve, these are the two biggest single users, but the actual cost curve is going to go down very low. So we're going to get to the point where the cost of batteries for electric cars no longer represents a significant portion of the total cost of an electric car. Now, when that happens, whether it's 5 years or 10 years, electric cars will be possibly with 200 mile range, 250 mile range, will be cheaper than the equivalent internal combustion engine car. And that's not just me talking. That's what Volkswagen think as well. This didn't get into the environmental press. I picked this up off the Petrolhead press, where the head of Volkswagen, or a very senior executive at Volkswagen, said that by 2020, there's strong indications that we'll be at a tipping point where the costs of manufacturing are the same for electric cars as they are for conventional cars. At that point, insurance costs will be lower because people don't accelerate as hard in EV cars as they do in petrol cars because they know it's going to run the batteries down. Maintenance costs are going to be lower. I went to a BMW garage to have a lustful chat about the BMW EV locally, and he said that the maintenance contract for an EV, a BMW EV, was £200 for 5 years. Compare that to what you paid when you last took your petrol car to the garage. And of course the running costs are very much lower because electricity per kilowatt hour is a lot cheaper. The costs of electricity you use to drive a mile are lower than the costs of petrol. So within 5 years, I would suggest, 5 to 10 years, depending on whether you believe we'll be VW bloke or not, we're going to have EVs that are roughly comparable or better than other cars. That, however, does not solve the crucial problem for the people in this room, if we are British people. That is to say, okay, we put a lot of PV on the ground, using up space that would otherwise be profitably occupied by sheep, and we find that in winter we don't get any sun at all. And what's more, we have weeks, possibly 2 weeks, when we don't get any wind. So however much we put in the North Sea, we're still going to have deficits. And what I did here was to look at 2015, the autumn of 2015, in the most difficult period of the year for renewables. That's the early autumn, before the sun's gone down, but the winds haven't really started blowing hard. And what I did was I multiplied the amount of wind, 6 times we have at the moment, which is actually not far off what the government is projecting, but we put 15 more times solar PV on the ground. And that still produces deficits of up to 1 or 2 terawatt hours over a period. So no wind, no sun, then we get down to -1, we have a shortage of electricity, and then the winds come in and we get back, and then there's a shortage again, 2 terawatt hours. What does that mean? That is roughly 0.5% of UK electricity consumption. So even with a huge amount more PV and a huge amount more wind, I would say, in the case of wind, not much more than the UK government's projecting we're going to get anyway. We have a huge need for storage for weeks and months. That is the crucial problem. The title of this talk was "The Energy Problem is Solved." I think it is for many places in the world, but for the 8% of the world that lives north of London, it's not necessarily solved because we don't have enough photovoltaics to take us through the short days of winter. So, what are we going to do about this? And we're coming 5 minutes.
You're fine.
Right, so this is what the last chapter of my book is about. I think it's the area where universities like Lancaster can very productively spend research time on. It is how we take the surpluses of electricity that we generated when the storms began, if you remember, 2015, in November, December, when electricity would become very cheap, very widely available. What do we do with that to make it useful so that the next time we have a shortage here, we have a form of energy which can provide us with everything we need? Well, I think what this is now becoming increasingly known as is reverse combustion. How do we take the CO2, probably from the atmosphere, combine it with hydrogen? These are the main constituents, the atoms that you constitute the majority of the fuel. Now, how do we take them in that simple form and take them back up to a complex molecule which sits as a gas or a liquid which can provide us with the energy we need, either to burn in our cars or in our electricity generating stations? This is what I think the big challenge is. How do we take that, the periods of the electricity we generate in surplus periods, and use it to make energy when we have a deficit? It's not too complicated. The actual chemistry of this is even up to my GCSE standard. It's not complex, not difficult. And I'm just going to talk very briefly about one extraordinarily interesting technology which shows us a way in which we might do this. And this is generating hydrogen from the electrolysis of water. You remember this, you did it in year 12 at school. You got hydrogen off one electrode and oxygen off the other. And you merge it with carbon dioxide, and you come out of it making what I call green methane, green CH, green CH4. These are very simple reactions. But this is waste gas. We don't want it in the atmosphere. This we can use as fuel. We might want to capture the CO2 that comes off it. But this is, in theory, a solution to the need for long-term storage, month-long storage, two-month-long storage for places like the UK. So this is just one illustration of the technologies available around the world for reverse combustion, using surplus electricity to make energy for us in the future. So this is the leading commercial trial in the world of that technology, what's called power to gas. It's a German technology which is installed in Copenhagen. You can tell it's Copenhagen because it's got a wind turbine in the harbour there. And this is the largest sewage farm at the outskirts of Copenhagen. It produces a gas which is a mixture of methane and carbon dioxide. It's fed in here along with water. The water is electrolyzed in this container here to make hydrogen. It's combined with the CO2. It flows up through that column. In that column are billions and billions and billions of ancient microbes called archaea, which existed before there was an oxygen-based atmosphere in the globe. And they eat the H2 and the carbon dioxide and exude only methane. So what you've got here is a plant which uses surplus electricity to make methane, which can be then fed into the conventional gas grid. Gas grids have enormous generating capacity to store electricity, often for months or even 6 months at a time, in the case of places like Austria and Slovakia. So we have here a technology for transmuting surplus energy into something which can provide us with the electricity we need when we don't have wind or sun. I won't go into this now, but that's an attempt to show that at the way solar photovoltaics are progressing around the world, this will be a cheaper way of generating natural gas, methane, than current gas prices on the UK wholesale market. Once again, highly contentious, but I believe that low-cost PV being used to create electrolysis and make methane is one of the four or five most important ways in which we are going to store electricity in places like the UK. Places like Hawaii, we just need batteries, but in the UK, we need something like that. That's my story. Thank you very much indeed for inviting me, and we should have some more questions if that's okay. Do you want to explain what a fuel cell is for people or not?
You're using electrolysis to produce
hydrogen,
and then using hydrogen with warming agents to produce electricity for a fuel cell, and obviously that's and used on satellites, and that's how I understood that technology was, but moving at the pace.
It's not moving anywhere near the pace of PV, is the problem. So that although the fossil fuel companies would like hydrogen to be the source, the carrier for energy for use in mobility, fuel cell cars, the problem they're all facing is that batteries plus electricity from PV is rapidly becoming cheaper. Fuel cells are not delivering the kind of cost reductions that is necessary. So, for example, Toyota, which has an existing fuel cell car, which takes hydrogen, turns it into electricity, and then uses that electricity to power an electric car, is saying, well, actually, that looks as though that's going to be more expensive than a battery car. Now, you don't have quite the same charging problems, but if you've got a car with a 250-mile range, most of your charging problems have disappeared because you'll be able to charge it at home. So I would contend, and this is once again it's virtually data-free assertion, but nevertheless I believe it, is that electric cars are going to be pure electric batteries, as opposed to hydrogen in fuel cells to generate electricity for mobility. But that's entirely because I believe that EVs are becoming so cheap, and batteries are becoming cheap at an equivalent and better rate, and therefore the long-run future for cars is batteries, not fuel cells. Now, in the case of large-scale fuel cell applications where you're using hydrogen or to generate electricity, the problem I see, and I deal with it tangentially in the book, is that hydrogen storage looks as though it's very expensive. There are 20 or so hydrogen filling stations for cars in this country. They cost an average of a $1.5 million each to equip with the capacity to store hydrogen. We cannot put hydrogen in large quantities into the gas grid. We could run a gas grid entirely based on hydrogen, and there's a plan to do some of it on a small scale in Leeds, even as we speak. But most of the UK wouldn't be able to cope with that because it retains steel or iron-based gas piping. It's only when the gas pipe is completely plastic, that the whole system is plastic, that we can use hydrogen. And Leeds has done that, so that it's going to be possible. I will be surprised if it ends up by being cheaper than equivalent non-hydrogen-based systems. But that time will tell.
Mine's a bit more light-hearted. I'm wondering why you're not at Davos presenting all this to the people
who made
the decision. That's funny. They didn't ask you. We should have gone.
I came out in favour of capitalism. I think capitalism is capable of making things work smoothly when markets are tempered by regulation and by non-excessive greed. I think Davos is an example of everything that's gone wrong with the world economy, to be honest. An elite that is completely and totally detached from the living circumstances of the world as a whole. I've been asked to do material in the past for Davos, and I produced something which was vaguely critical of the existing capitalist status quo. And I wasn't asked about it. I've never been, but I was asked to prepare the material. I sent my material in, and I was told that my work would not be necessary.
Have you presented it to the Department of Energy? What happens there?
No. Look, the problem with it, yeah, forgive
political
me.
Political will, yeah.
It's not. They're all terribly nice people, but they don't follow what's going on. No, there's nobody in there who says, actually, we have got to work out not what's happening in the UK. We're going to watch the whole world, look for technologies that are really working, and then back those technologies. So, Tidal Lagoons is a very interesting example. The Tidal Lagoon in Swansea will be very, very, very expensive indeed per unit of electricity. But what the entrepreneurs behind that say is once we've learned how to do it, we will be able to build a world-class Tidal Lagoon technology in the UK, which we can export to other places around the world. With strong tidal up and down range. You will not, but that to the current ideology is betting on the future of the technology. Governments are not supposed to do that. My view is you have to do that. The US government, for example, is much less inhibited about doing this. You have to make a decision about what's going to work. And I think the evidence on the tidal lagoons, I've known the entrepreneurs behind it for ever since they started. I find them incredibly impressive, so I'm a very gullible person. So I might be wrong, but I believe their story that you can build tidal lagoons to be half the price of nuclear power stations in the UK.
The government did bet, though. They bet on fracking, don't they?
Well, they're not betting on fracking. They're going to allow it, and then you're going to be able to go out and frack what's the name of the... Sorry, I keep on... Bowland Chain. But my view is that if the UK, for example, had bet on wind, the UK decided about 30 years ago it was not going to bet on wind turbines, and as a result, the wind industry that should have been in the UK disappeared to Vestas in Denmark and to the Spanish competitor and the German competitors. We have walked away. We have never missed an opportunity to miss an opportunity. there are certain things that the UK has abundant resources of, which we ought to be able to exploit, both for our own energy supply, but also to be able to export to the rest of the world. And you hear that rubbish that's talked... Oh, sorry, I'm sure.
I would like to challenge a bit about the global rules about the feed service route.
Yeah.
I just want to give an example you probably already know. In China, in the last year, you see about 30% of growth, that's correct? But at the same time, you also see about 30% giving away electricity from both wind and solar. I don't think this trend is going to be sustainable. I think that's it's a tremendous policy problem, and the government are trying to encourage the installation because of the economy, the station basically now, and the exporting rate is going down, and they want to keep the industry. That's the intention is good, but they just cannot take the challenges. You mentioned that they discussed about the land use, but there are many major challenges facing the industry and the society.
What you're saying, of course, is absolutely true, that a large fraction of the PV that was put in place in China last year wasn't immediately connected to the national electricity grids. But when you look at China, I saw yesterday a map of the proposed new high voltage DC transmission routes from West China to East China. That is a staggering, utterly staggering amount of capacity to take wind and solar from the east of the country from the west of the country to the east of the country. Now, I defer to you, I don't know what's actually happening on the ground, but I do sense from reading the Chinese government's policy pronouncement that they understand that they have to find a way of using this electricity that they have so expensively subsidized to put in. Because PV electricity in China is by no means there's not that much sun in lots parts of China, and as I understand it, so that it is not yet cost competitive, and it will be 2 or 3 years before it is. But it seems to me, and I could be wrong, that the Chinese energy plan, which was produced 4 or 3 weeks ago, did say quite explicitly we are going to put $360 billion, or equivalent in yuan, into renewables, of which 40% is going to be PV. Now, either that's the piece of the most magnificent grandstanding to show just how committed China is to PV, or it really thinks this is a cheap way, potentially, of building an energy supply and a supply of PV for the rest of the world. I defer to you on whether that is likely to be genuine or not, but I think the commitment from China. Remember, as a world as a whole last year, more money was put into renewables than all types of energy generation put together. China was a very, very important ingredient in that, but by no means the same thing. The same thing is happening in India. Now, you may say, well, perhaps they're not going to connect it to the grid. But both in China and India, we have seen grid connections to the two single largest existing solar photovoltaic farms in the world in the last 3 months. So I think those countries will find ways of getting round the problem of actually being able to use all the electricity, connecting it into the sources of demand. But I'm not an expert, I can't read Chinese, so I have no idea what's really going on, but it looks pretty impressive to me.
You touched on that in the last question. I wanted to ask what
about the technology and the politics and the economics of the long distance power transmission. So you've just talked about an east to west one in China.
Lots of them. I mean,
it's being mooted about putting stuff in the Sahara. And especially, I think, with climate change, the increased precipitation, and bringing all that reliable sunshine up to the industrialised north.
What I think will happen, if I may say so, is in very sunny places, like, for example, Chile, we'll see the conversion of sunshine into methane, and then the shipment of methane long distances to generate electricity. Because I think that's going to be politically and logistically easy to do. So Chile, for example, is a very, that is the clearest possible example of that today. Best sunshine in the world in the Atacama Desert, but it's 300 miles from Santiago. So they have to build a very important line. But why not, instead of building a line, turn it into liquefied natural gas and export it? They can do so, I suggest, at prices, because that's the cheapest electricity, it's going to be the cheapest place to generate PV in the world, they can significantly undercut Qatar's supply of liquefied natural gas within a few years. I didn't show it here, but the latest Atacama Desert government auction, the people were bidding to provide electricity from solar photovoltaics at less than 3 cents a kilowatt hour. That's lower than gas, because it's substantially lower than gas generation in the United States, where gas is at its cheapest. So I don't know what's going to happen, but in Europe, the single biggest issue with electricity transmission is getting surplus renewable energy out of southern Germany into northern Germany, and it's politically extraordinarily difficult to handle. And so large portions of that line are going to have to be built underground through Bavaria. And that's going to make it very costly, but obviously German coalition politics make it absolutely vital that that happens. But without it, we're going to see the same phenomenon as we've seen in, as we see in China, with a lot of the renewable energy actually not being productively used.
For these rather remote power to gas systems that you're now sketching, is there a general source of CO2? I mean, taking it from air is typically the most costly way, because then you have a separation process.
Right.
So ideally you would have industrial plants nearby where you have CO2 anyway.
That's what I want to talk about in the session with your group tomorrow.
Okay, thanks for the announcement. So there will be another session tomorrow.
Well, I look at what the underlying economics of taking CO2 out of the air seem to be. And I should say, I come from economic statistics, so I know nothing about it. I've got O-level chemistry, very good grade, but O-level chemistry only. So one of the reasons I wanted to talk to Harry's group is get a better feel for the underlying chemistry and how much energy loss there is in the conversion of chemicals. But I'm very interested in direct capture of CO2 from the air, because it seems to me the world is going to need that. We are going to massively overshoot on the CO2 percentages that in of the atmosphere. We're going to have to extract it. How do we do so in a way that doesn't add hugely to the cost of running the world? Well, I say, look, every time I look at the economics, it's entirely dependent upon the underlying cost of energy that you use to collect the CO2. And if you come tomorrow, I'll try and explain my understanding of it so that you can correct it. But once we've got very, very cheap electricity, then it becomes, in my opinion, very, very cheap to collect directly collect electricity, sorry, CO2 from the atmosphere. And we can then use that as the base feedstock for our fuels that we make from CO2 and hydrogen.
Yeah. Would you give a comment about the photovoltaic industry? Because it's kind of immature, or it has problems in the past. So in your curve, the Schwarzschild curve, there was a blip around 2004, and that was when silicon was very scarce and it went up. As you know, in Germany, it was all the photovoltaic producers 15, 20 years ago, and now they're all in China. So, and there are so many companies in the United States that are just shutting down after one after the other, and the one that survived is one run by Schwarzschild himself. So I'm just a bit worried that if you give all the power to someone to import the photovoltaic modules, we'll have the same thing that happens with the wind turbines, and how you make sure it's going to stay cheap by only by demand and supply? Is that going to be, I don't know, that's economics, I don't understand.
Well, so I suppose the background to that question is, and we've got to be careful what language we use here, but a very large fraction of photovoltaic modules are now made in China. That's putting, there'll be no short, that we won't see that silicon refining capacity problem again, which was the result of the call, I don't think. But we have innovations taking place here and here, which will start a new manufacturing.
But that will be 50 years from now, because the industry is not there.
Well, there's 80 million euros going into this factory.
Oh, I'm sorry, the organics will never make it. They have to
have 10-year lifetime by now.
I don't believe the organics will never
make it. You don't believe it because?
Poor efficiency.
Have you seen what these people are now claiming for efficiency? You think they're lying? 20% efficiency compared to 18 for a standard PV panel. Okay, well, I'm sure you know more about it than I do, but these people have to be seriously lying.
I know this, but can I tell you
it's not a lie?
20% efficient panel of the organic. No way they have 20% efficient panel.
If you give me your email, I'll send you the
reference. I'll be tomorrow in the talk.
Okay.
Okay, so coming back out to the is the energy problem solved? So I think it's a pretty compelling case for the technologies are emerging and they can come together in a timely manner. So would it be right in saying that there are two critical questions? What would be, can we and how can we get the investment, enough investment into it fast enough? In particular, and away from the fossil fuels and into this kind of stuff. Question number one. And the two being, kind of hinges around the idea that we can stabilize demand, right, which has come up a couple of times already today. So would you agree that kind of whether we've solved the energy problem depends on the question, can we, and if so, how can we stabilize global energy demand and not let it just rise in line with supply?
Well, in the book I say that global energy demand now, you know, I said it was roughly 4 kilowatts per person in the UK. Across the world, the world at this moment is typically consuming 17 or 18 terawatts. That's compared to 90,000 terawatts arriving from the sun, by the way. So we're not using a lot of that solar energy. And any other source of energy available to us is two orders of magnitude less. Renewable source of energy, two orders of magnitude less than so. My projection, and it would be very different to BP, is that will probably rise to around 30 terawatts. A rise of somewhere around 40-45%. And we've got, at that point, we've given everybody in the world 3 kilowatts of energy.
And then in your view, it will top out. Because human appetite for energy will.
Right. The alternative view is that energy becomes so cheap that we'll leave the lights on. But as long as that energy, that electricity, is entirely renewable, that may be silly, but it's not a bad thing for the environment.
And we won't feel the need to have holidays on the moon trampoline.
Well, you and I have had this debate many times, right? I think we reached, in the UK, we reached something called peak stuff in 2004. And I wrote about this, it's got a lot of data behind it, but it's not widely agreed. I think that there's no evidence that I think there's strong evidence that once an economy has built all its infrastructure, which may then crumble, but once you've got it, the actual amount of energy and materials used by society stabilizes and then falls. You think that's utter nonsense. I don't think we're going to solve it.
What about the rise in electricity demand from IoT and communications and gadgets and data centers and all those things which are threatening to increase a bigger proportion of electricity usage?
Yeah. I think that I got a press release today which said that IT this is somebody trying to sell something, so you might believe it. IT is now something like 10% of world electricity, of which servers, data centers, 4% of world electricity. The only good thing is the people who run those data centers have the strongest worldwide incentive to do something about the source of their energy. So, Google, Amazon, Apple have all made commitments to 100% renewable sources of electricity. Now, that doesn't solve the problem because it just means they buy all the capacity and everybody else has to do the dirty electricity. But it's a gesture, and I think it's an important signal to the rest of the corporate environment that they ought to do similarly. And what people like Google and Amazon are now saying is that that renewable energy is cheaper than conventional sources of energy for them. Which makes me optimistic that that's yet a further incentive towards the faster development of renewables. But you're absolutely right, of course, although pretty much 100% of the adult population of the world has got a mobile phone, they don't have computers. On the other hand, the biggest single advances in energy efficiency in the last few years have been in domestic computing, as we've moved from heavy under-the-table things to relatively efficient laptops and tablets. So I'm optimistic we're not going to see an unsustainable rise in the percentage of demand coming from electricity use in IT. But I feel very, very weak ground.
My question was going to be similar, but I was going to ask about air conditioning. The need for air conditioning, demand for air conditioning as global temperatures rise,
yeah,
is surely going to bust a lot of that.
We've made a lot of advances in air conditioning, a great deal. Well, they historically have been some of the least efficient machines in terms of energy out and useful energy compared to what goes in. But we are going to have to produce a heck of a lot more air conditioning as time goes on. However, once again, if I may just be bold and say, that's electricity. We can get rid of the problem. It's going to be much more difficult to get rid of the problem in countries like this one of excess heat. Of excess coal, having to spend a lot of money heating inefficient. So I don't want to seem complacent, but if we really are going to get very cheap electricity, then people are going to be able to run their own air conditioning systems. And those air conditioning systems are becoming more efficient. But there's no question about it. If you live in a hot country, that's going to be, after you've got the TV and the refrigerator, probably the air conditioning would be next. And that's perfectly reasonable. So, and that is a huge jump in total electricity consumption. But the great thing is, it tends to happen at times when the sun is in the sky. Whereas our maximum energy needs in the UK, of course, occur when the sun isn't in the sky.
I always find it very hard to know how to. I think we've taken questions all night. Are you okay to take a few more?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So
my voice is going.
Yeah. Okay. So let's. When we do stop, there'll still be wine and stuff and chance to go pretty further over that and stuff. So should we just take another five more or something like that?
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. Yes. There are three questions in that group there. So it sounds like you all get a chance.
I think you've actually got the nub of the problem in the intermittency of renewables is, to me, the problem that means you've got to have better energy storage.
Right.
The solution you came up with, I'm afraid as a biologist, you said, okay, I need a process that combines water, carbon dioxide, to produce organics. That's photosynthesis. So what we should be doing is saying, can we make photosynthesis more efficient, or how does the efficiency of the processes we're looking at compare to photosynthesis?
Okay, that's tomorrow again. I'm sorry, because clearly, I think we'll go through a phase of upscaling simple waste molecules to fuels through biological or chemical processes, but what we'll end up with in 30 years' time is artificial photosynthesis, where a photon from the sun hits something and creates a change which produces a molecule which we like. And particularly on the west coast of the United States, some very, very interesting experiments on this. Nanotechnology makes this all very, very much easier, but it's a long way from where I could show a photograph of a field in Copenhagen. So I just felt that was the one to go for a minute. But the end point of this is directly converting photons from the sun into the molecules we want without going through these intermediate steps. And there's some, you know, there are, once again, an advert for the book, there are four or five case histories of particularly US scientists beginning the process of getting to the point where they're doing this. But we're still talking, you know, photosynthesis, remember, in plants is the maximum of 2% efficiency, roughly. A photovoltaic cell now, a good one, put on the ground without anything fancy about it, is 20%. So we're getting 10 times as much energy from the same surface area, approximately, as we would do with a plant. So we've got a long way to go, but these artificial photosynthesis technologies are potentially very low cost indeed. But my suspicion is, and I think there's some old skepticism in the room about this, these two will become incredibly low cost as well. But only time will tell. Sorry, there's another question over here.
One was about, I think it was the third question on Mike's list. How do you persuade customers to want it and get increase the rate of uptake? And I think it's actually about whether customers want it. I think it's, what I see is people who sell things to customers but lock them into old forms of energy don't believe customers want it.
Are we talking about renewable electricity?
I'm talking about houses, yeah. Housing, for instance. Near us, we had three fields about to go to housing. The houses will last for 100 years. The guys who are going to build on those houses really believe in selling good quality, comfortable houses to people and work for people. But at the moment, that quality does not include zero carbon, does not include passive housing, does not include high insulation, does not include solar panel on the roof. Because they don't think people want it. Where is the evidence that we all need to go around showing these guys that commercially it works and that people actually want it? I need it tomorrow.
Well, that's one of the reasons I spent the early part of my writing life 10 years ago talking about how you get the economics of doing, for example, passive house building. You look at the numbers and it sort of makes sense financially, but as you say, large companies, large construction companies in the UK have been extraordinarily resistant to making this happen. They want to turn out essentially the same house 1,000 times, preferably as many as possible on that single site, and they are worried that any move away from conventional housing design cuts demand.
Unless we persuade them to do this, Jeff,
yeah,
your rates of progress won't be taken up by the market.
Well, so I said, look, okay, so if we have to live with the system as it is in places like the UK, and we can't persuade Wimpy to build properly, we have to make the energy that is inefficiently used in those homes carbon-free. And that, I've tried to suggest in my writing, may well be a cheaper, quicker, and simpler way of getting to decarbonisation than persuading Wimpy and the people like that to build passive housing. But that, to some extent, despair. One of the most formative experiences I had as a writer and journalist in this is going to some really low carbon, housing development produced by a mass market builder in Milton Keynes about 6 or 7 years ago. They were, I thought, absolutely beautiful houses, unconventional. They looked sort of Dutch, and I can't remember who it was Lang. A builder struggled to sell them, even at prices which were no higher per square foot than conventional mock Georgian. And their cost to build them was more. And they absolutely hated it. And halfway through that 300 house construction site, they went back to Prince Charles approved design. Sad, absolutely desperately sad. And there's still a group trying to, the people who bought the 150 absolutely love them. And they have met their desire. There's have been a few problems with that for a couple of the houses, but they've met their energy use objectives. So those people are saving money. But the thing was, the punter didn't want to buy. What they wanted was HRH's approval, and that came with the rubbish that they produced for the 750. I have to say, I've built a part passive house with my wife, and it's pretty costly. Sorry.
I was going to say, where do you think the code for sustainable homes fits in that picture then? Because in essence, why can't we force some implementation of renewable?
But the government decided it wouldn't do that under pressure from the house building lobby that said we'll have to charge more people than we want.
Zero carbon houses are not difficult to
build. I would slightly differ from you, but I can see that there shouldn't be. And the evidence from places where it's being adopted is that it's not that expensive, incremental to the underlying cost, and you get it back in energy savings and hugely back in comfort. You don't have the wind whistling around your ankles on a cold Sunday night. Right, but even if we said all houses ever built in the UK from now on are going to be zero carbon, we've still got the 99% that are constructed. Every time I look at the economics of trying to turn those into houses which consume a quarter of heat demands that they do at the moment, it looks a pretty expensive job. It's feasible to do that, but not if you're borrowing at commercial rates. It would be my judgment. There's some counterexamples in the book, because it's clearly central. 25% of the UK's energy demand is flowing out of the walls of our houses. And that could easily, we could decide to make that 5%. It would be costly, but we'd have a healthier, happier, and richer population here. So one of my hopes for the next few years is that we say it is no longer acceptable to have 25,000 people dying from air pollution every year in the UK resulting from fossil fuel use, and it's not acceptable to have 25,000 people dying prematurely from cold homes, which is roughly what we saw last year. But I don't see the political will to make it happen. Sorry, there's still a gentleman who's been waiting a long time.
heavy freight and floods.
Has that been built into
the
model? Heavy freight and floods?
Yeah. Okay. It was my understanding that batteries can't hold housing or electricity to move heavy goods or long distance.
That's what BP, Mike's favourite source, says. Yes. I would say that the evidence is increasing that we're going to get the rates of charging are clearly going to rise. So there's a lot of 50 kilowatt plus installations being put into the United States now on the long distance routes. And this is all happening in the United States. There is no reason why heavy freight cannot be moved using batteries. There are now some lorries, some trucks which do that. Partway there, though, are buses. And buses will actually be, in my opinion, the first thing to go to completely electric. They have restricted mileage per day, and they always return to base. There's no problem about charging, and the costs of electric buses are now coming down to rough equivalent to diesel. And buses go where air pollution is at its worst, urban buses. So there's an urgent, and so even the UK is coming to realise that we cannot continue to have the air quality in city centres that it seems to have at the moment. The simplest and cheapest way of doing that is insisting on electric buses. There is no reason why buses can't be switched. Some electric, some heavy freight cannot be, and there are various plans for putting charging routes on motorways which charge inductively the batteries. But, you know, okay, 25 years away. A problem. Flights, okay, what we're going to see in flights is the use of kerosene, but it's going to be kerosene made from the sort of things I was trying to talk about here, or indirectly from biomass. And in the last year, we had four or five airlines commit to buying the entire capacity of biomass factories, which turn wood chips, waste wood, into kerosene substitutes in the United States and in other places. Now, the worry then is you just use all the wood in the world, but once again, what we need to do is plant the whole of the Lake District with trees so that we don't have to shoot there.
Okay, so there won't be a natural endpoint, but we have to stop somewhere. So, Chris, thanks very much for...